Hi, my name is Fons, and today I'll tell you one fun fact about Julia, which is that functions are objects. So what does that mean? Well, you've seen that we can apply functions to a number, for example, and the square root of 49 is the object 7. You've seen us apply functions to multiple arguments. But what if we don't give it any arguments? It's not giving us an error. It's not saying, oops, you forgot to give it arguments. It's just saying square root is an object. And it is a generic function with 19 methods. This actually brings us to my first use case, which is that I don't really like the name SQRT. I think it's kind of vague. And if I'm sharing my code with someone else, maybe I'd like to give it a more clear name. So let's just say square root equals SQRT. It worked. And now I can just use square root like a function. And so the point of this video will be this one idea: functions are objects, and we're going to explore this idea and just see what it brings us. Okay, as a first example, I have two functions, one called double, which returns x times 2, and half, which returns x divided by 2. And now, because both functions are objects, I can just create an array containing double and half. And that worked, and the result is an array, a two-element array of functions. First element is double, second is half. So if we take the first element, we just get the function double, and we can apply it to a number, and we get 2 for 6. Right, let's take the second one, also works. We can do something fun, like take a random function from that array, and then apply it to 1, 2, 3. So every time we run this, random function gets chosen. Very cool. So the point here is that functions can do anything that objects can do. And for example, you can use them as arguments to another function. So we can say, create a function called apply both that takes a function f, function g, and an object x. And what it does, it applies both functions one by one to x, and it returns the result. So right, can as arguments give double, double again, and then 10, and we see that we get 40, and we can put half there, and we get 10. All right, so these were just some fun examples to get like the wheels turning, but in the next section, I'll show you some ways how this can be useful to make your code easier to understand for both you and for other people reading your code. Alright, so functions are objects, and this is the core idea behind something called functional programming. And two important concepts there are map and filter. And to demonstrate this, I've prepared a data set, which is just an array of 7 dogs. And so each dog is a struct, and it has a name, an age, and a photo. Okay, so it's an array, which means that we can like take the first one and look at the name. Okay, so say that we need to show the photos of all dogs older than 7 years. So the first thing we might think of is to use for loops, and we would start out with an empty array and then loop through the dogs, and if it's old enough, then add it to that array. But today I'd like to show you something else, another way to write this, which is to use a filter. So if you look at the dogs for filter, it wants to take a function and a collection, and it returns a copy of that collection, removing elements for which the function is false. Okay, let's just look at an example. So we need to filter based on a function. It will take a function as arguments. So our function will be is old, taking dog, and it's old if age is more than 7. Okay, and now we will filter using this function on our collection, and the result is also an array, but it's the subset of dogs where this function is true. So for example, Floop is 13 years old, so this function is true, so it ends up in the array. Hannes is 5 years old, so this function returns false, and it does not end up in the array. Just to show you everything today, I'll show you two different ways to write this, which can be shorter or easier to understand. So both create anonymous functions. So instead of defining the function somewhere else and giving it a name, you can define functions right there. So the first one is the arrow function. I can say dogs goes to dog.h is greater than 7, and it gives me the same. And then the last one, maybe a little tricky to understand, but super useful. It's called do. So instead of giving the function as the argument, I leave out the first argument and I write do, and then create a block with an end block with the end word. And so now I'm creating a function that takes a dog and returns, again, dog.h is greater than 7, and it's the same. So what do does is it takes the call that comes before it, creates a function with the thing that comes after it, and puts that function as the first argument of the function call. Okay, so our challenge was to show the photos of these dogs. So to go from this array to just the photos, I need to map each datum, so each dog, to just its photo. And so we're going to use a map. So let's call these our special dogs. And for the map, it's the same idea. It takes a function and a collection as argument, except now the function will be applied to every element and you get a collection back of the same size. So let's use this do syntax again. So let's get the second argument now, the special dogs. And the first argument is a function that goes from a dog to its photo. Special dogs. There you go. Okay, so why introduce new syntax to do exactly the same thing? well, the reasoning is that this kind of coding, the functional style of programming, is easier for you to understand and easier for others to understand. And actually, at some point, you're going to spend more time reading code in your life than writing code. So it's very important for your code to be clear. If you use loops, then you expect the person that's reading it to, in their head, kind of follow through with those loops and, you know, run loops in your head. And then at some point, they themselves are a Julia interpreter. And sometimes it's just easier to describe your next data as a map of the first data or a filter on the first data. All right. Hope it's useful. See you soon.